Thank you very much, Mr. President. Good morning to all. I'm honored to be able to speak to the Broadband Commission, and I'm very grateful that I have this opportunity, and I thank you all for inviting me. I was asked to share with you some of the experiences of Costa Rica to this regard. I would like to recognize that in the process of building connectivity in my country, there's great contributions from Professor Sachs and Negroponte for many years, so I acknowledge the presence here, and I'm thankful for their support and the work they've done in Costa Rica. What I'm going to say is just what we're doing in addressing the second guiding question of this morning, what we're doing at this point in the country. But I would like to mention the fact that there's a backdrop in this, and it's not a small one. Costa Rica has been investing in public education for over 150 years. And this has been consisting since the late 19th century. Our first girls' school was founded in 1838. That was less than 10 years before the country became a republic. And currently, the Constitution says that we have to invest up to 8% of our GDP in public education, including universities. So there's a lot of, you know, there's a weight here in terms of where we've been putting our efforts for many generations, and that's a significant point I would like to make. And the second is that we've realized that girls, young people, and people with special needs are amongst the poorest of the poor in Costa Rica, as they are everywhere else. So during my administration that has been in government for the past year and roughly a year and a half, we have been focusing most of our policies to address the needs of these individuals. So what we would like to do in the future is to help with telecommunications and connectivity, the advancement of these three populations, knowing that the knowledge economy is the future, and that unless we do something with them, they're going to be lagging behind, and we're not going to be able to recover there or people like them around the world. So we do believe that the eradication of poverty is the endeavor which should start with ensuring that the most vulnerable populations have equal access to tools and resources. And that's the reason why next October 5th, just next week, we will be launching the National Telecommunications Development Plan, which is significantly named a connected society. And it's what we would like to be our route to 2021, which is the centennial of our independence, the bicentennial of our independence in Central America. This plan is based on three pillars: digital inclusion, electronic and transparent government, and digital economy. The National Digital Strategy, called CR Digital, is framed in the digital inclusion pillar and focuses on solving the issues related to accessibility to telecommunications by vulnerable groups and the need to promote the development of capacities, knowledge, and skills for the productive and significant use of information and communication tools. With the goal of reducing the connectivity gap among socioeconomically vulnerable homes or households, we will implement by 2018 the Connected Household Program, by which over 140,000 families will receive free internet access and subsidized computers. This program will benefit families led by entrepreneurial women, which will then help overcome the digital access barrier, which addresses the goal, the first goal of eradication of poverty in the Sustainable Development Strategy. You have invited us to identify areas and initiatives where technology is making a difference in people's lives. And this is what I would like to share you about our experience in Costa Rica, because we are convinced that access to technology has the potential to radically change people's lives, as it has been stated here before. Aware of this reality, we are committed to achieving universal access to telecommunication services, just as we did to public education back in the 19th century, reaching those locations without internet coverage to the lack of commercial interest by private carriers. With the Connected Communities Program, we will guarantee access to internet and online calling to communities with connectivity gap through an investment of over $167 million. By the end of 2017, we will have connected over half of the country's districts which will directly benefit not only families, but also schools, medical centers, and other community centers. This is something that has been very important. I mean, allowing this connectivity to go beyond education to cover other areas of the economy, and particularly those pertaining medical services and access to finance, for example. My government places a special emphasis on those populations in vulnerable situations, as I've mentioned, which is why the National Telecommunications Development Plan has taken the challenge of providing internet access to all the indigenous peoples who do not enjoy the services today. They live mostly on the borders or coastlines of the country, which are amongst, again, the poorest in the land. In order to ensure quality education, where teachers and students have access to electronic devices as tools to enhance teaching and learning, we have initiated a process to provide equipment to those schools which today they do not have. Through the program of Connected Public Centers, or Intelligent Community Centers, $20 million will be used to acquire 40,000 such devices for education and school-age care centers. Additionally, we have the full conviction that technology is a tool that must be complemented with training that allows teachers to make the most of it. We have also included the regular population in these courses, so they will be able to use the program for the digital empowerment of the population in generally, adding this literacy component. Again, this has to do with goal number 4, addressing quality of education. Reducing the number of employed youth is a task that needs to be started without delay. And here what we've done is to start a program which has been launched last week to generate 30,000 new jobs in the next 2.5 years. And this has been designed specially for young people, women, and people with special needs. So far in the last 10 days, over 300 companies have joined the program. Over 10,000 people have already been involved in the program. And it includes a subsidy of 4 months' salary that the government will provide for these companies to hire new employees for a minimum of 1 year. The idea being that if they're good workers, it is going to be very difficult for these companies to lay them off after 1 year, and that they will stay having access to this technology. So unemployment has become a major source of inspiration for this program. And this is an issue that, as members of the board of the International Telecommunication Unions, we have brought the attention to all countries about. As a result, we adopted this year a resolution on empowering youth through telecommunications and information technologies and communications. More recently, in the framework of the meeting of the Standing Advisory Committee of CITEL at the OAS last week, Costa Rica presented a regional action plan proposal to achieve youth empowerment through telecommunications and information technology, which addresses goal 8 of decent work and economic growth. I would like to conclude by expressing how much and how honored I am for having been named this year's ITU Patron for Youth and ICT, and reaffirm the commitment of my country to encourage and support the use of ICTs for positive social change and economic progress. I thank you very much.